Good evening, Rowan. It's the 14th of April, 2017, and it's about 11:30. And obviously, this is my usual Friday evening video to reassure you I won't be seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. In fact, I'm not even too sure I'm going to be seeing any priests over the weekend, because people do save up their worst abuse and harassment and torment for major Christian festivals such as Easter. So I haven't been able to participate in any of the special events of Holy Week this week because of the inundation of abuse I would have experienced if I'd taken part in it. In fact, it started last Saturday when I was in the church last Saturday morning. It was very bad. And it was heading that way when I was in the church earlier this week. So the special services of Holy Week, I haven't been able to take part in, which is, I can't tell you how devastating that is. And every year, I think, well, next year, don't worry, next year I'll be able to take part and everyone will leave me alone. And every year they just tip another year of my life down the drain. Because it means absolutely nothing to anybody. And they just keep on torturing and tormenting me and deluding themselves that they're helping me. And then they laugh at me when I become distressed. So this is what I'm dealing with. And you're going to have a lot of company in jail by the time I've finished. Because whichever self-satisfied bunch of middle-class twats it was who sat down in a committee and decided it was in my best interests to torture me to death for nearly a decade so far. Those bastards are going to jail. I am never letting this go. And then, of course, it had to be authorised. So I'm going to get to the bottom of who's behind this, who's authorised it, and who's been coordinating it. And they're going to jail, and I'm never letting it go. So your cell might be overcrowded. That's assuming you don't kill yourself before you go there, I suppose. So you'll have plenty of burly cell mates, won't you? Lots of superior middle class people, not trash like me. So you'll be happy about that, won't you? So anyway, I thought we could have a chat this evening about some sermons that you've been giving at a church in Manhattan. So there you are, back at the scene of the crime. So you've given several sermons this week and a question and answer session you did on Sunday. You've been doing a sermon every day, and I've just listened to the one that you gave this evening, actually live, about half an hour ago. So it's too late to cover that, but suffice to say, it was probably the longest stream of insanity I've ever sat through in my entire life. So, I'm going to talk this evening about half of the sermon that you gave on Wednesday evening. So this is from 2 days ago, the 12th of April, 2017. I did listen to yesterday evening's as well, but that wasn't very interesting. There was only about one interesting sentence in it, and the rest of it, you're just repeating the same things over and over again anyway. So without further ado, I'll move on to what you were saying on Wednesday, the 12th of April, 2017. So here we go. We have been reflecting this week on the way that Jesus' trial and death transforms how we understand power. So you have been reflecting over that, and it has been quite hilarious, I have to say. So you then go on to say, and last night in our journey through these narratives, we were thinking about how Jesus's capacity to uncover, you emphasize that, uncover the real questions people were asking rather than the ones they think they're asking, and you emphasize that, is one of the manifestations of transforming power. Now, I've talked about this in relation to you before in a lecture that you gave about Dostoevsky, at the Royal Society of Literature sometime around June 2016, where you were talking about one of the characters in one of his novels, who had a gift of getting to the bottom of things or something like that. So you think, or you're trying to convince people that you're getting to the bottom of me by subjecting me to all this torture and relentless abuse and all these fucking lunatics harassing me all the time and deluding themselves that they're helping me. So you think you're getting to the bottom of things, but what you're actually doing is trying to force and coerce me to act out the character that you've created for me in your fantasy world. Obviously, you want my breasts available to you because you've got a fetish about breasts, which I've demonstrated recently in a video. But there's more to it than that, you know, because you have to be superior to everybody, and you need everybody kissing your ass and telling you you're wonderful. And I'm just not that kind of person. And you're not wonderful, quite obviously. You're a complete and utter scumbag. You're as mad as a hatter. You're a psychopath. You're a sexual predator. You're a fake Christian. That's not even a strong enough expression for it. You're an imposter. You're someone pretending to be a Christian who has no intention of being a Christian. In fact, you look down on Christians. You look down on everybody, but you look down on Christians, especially the ones who are taken in by you and think you're a real Christian. But anyway, so this is your character. But you need to feel superior to everybody. So if anybody demonstrates in any way whatsoever that you're not superior to them, then you're quite infuriated by this. This is the one of the reasons why you hate Donald Trump so much, actually. It's got nothing to do with his political views. It's because he's a very successful businessman, a self-made billionaire. He's an alpha male. You see him there, very successful. And also, he's always surrounded when he's with his family by very glamorous women. His wife and daughters, they're all very glamorous, and this makes you furiously jealous, and this is the real reason why you hate him. It's got nothing to do with his political views whatsoever. So, that's me getting to the bottom of you. You've been pretending that you've been discerning me and helping me with all this crap that you've been putting me through for decades. But the real thing you want is access to my breasts, and you want me to act in the way that your mother did and tell you you're wonderful and rescue you from every difficult situation that you've got into. Well, I've told you this thousands of times. I'm not your mother and I'm not giving you what you want. So you might as well stop play acting and accept the boundaries that I'm setting because they won't be moving. So I've actually got a capacity to uncover the real questions people are asking, and you haven't. You just try and force people to act in the way that you've decided they will act in this fantasy that's going on in your head. So you then say, we were reflecting on that moment in his trial. This is Jesus's trial before the high priests. You emphasize priests, as recorded by St. Luke. I hope you're not referring to yourself as a priest there, because don't forget you're completely null and utterly void. The high priest, as recorded by St. Luke, where he asked, are you the Messiah? So let's have a look at this passage. So it's Luke 22, verses 67 to 70. They said, if you are the Messiah, tell us. He replied, if I tell you, you will not believe, and if I question you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. All of them asked, are you the Son of God? He said to them, you say that I am. So you say, we were reflecting on that moment in his trial before the high priests, as recorded by St. Luke, where he is asked, "Are you the Messiah?" And he replies bluntly, and you emphasize bluntly, "If I tell you, you will not believe. If I ask you, you will not answer." And that takes us forward into the next phase of his trial before Pontius Pilate, this time as narrated, and you emphasize narrated, in the Gospel according to Saint John. So I don't think you're talking about the trial of Jesus. I think you're talking about the trial of you. So there's the trial before the high priests. This is what you're talking about here. So this is all your carrying on in the church and what you've been doing to me and that kind of thing. And the fact that you're a fraud as a Christian and an academic fraud and all this kind of thing. So I think that's what you're talking about here. And you use the word bluntly, and I've said in previous videos that when you say to put it bluntly, the next thing that you're going to say after that is always the biggest load of crap you've ever heard in your entire life. So I think that what you then say after this, if I tell you, you will not believe, if I ask you, you will not answer. And that takes us forward into the next phase of his trial before Pontius Pilate. So Jesus was talking to the high priest, so that was the church authorities. Not, it wasn't the church for him, I mean, I'm talking in relation to you. So that represents the church. And Pontius Pilate represents the state. He was the Roman governor. So the next phase of his trial before Pontius Pilate, this time as it's narrated in the Gospel according to St. John. So I've talked about you being involved with the New World Order, and one way in which I demonstrated that was your promotion of the agenda of the United Nations. And I said that the United Nations uses symbolism of the Antichrist, and they've borrowed this symbolism from Islam because in one of the hadith, Muhammad is quoted as saying that Ad-Dajjal, who is the Antichrist in Islam, is one-eyed and Allah is not, and this is referred to in a couple of different hadith. And I've sh shown slides of this in this video where it tells you that these are narrated by a certain person. So I think this is what you're saying here, that when you say bluntly, what you're saying after this, this is the biggest load of crap that you've ever heard, that you're involved with the New World Order and the Antichrist. So I think that's what you're saying, but the thing is, Rowan, you haven't provided any evidence for that, have you? Whereas I've provided an awful lot of evidence, and you still haven't explained why all your clocks say 9/11, have you? So anyway, you're saying this is the biggest load of crap that you've ever heard, or that anyone's ever heard, or this kind of thing. But it isn't. It's absolutely spot on. It's the truth. So you then say, St. John emphasizes very strongly that initially, when Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, he says nothing. So silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. And you emphasize this and say it slowly, "Do you not realize I have power over you?" He says to Jesus. This is what you say. So this is a passage from St. John's Gospel, chapter 19, beginning at verse 9. So Pilate had found no case against Jesus. So he asks him where he's from. And Jesus doesn't answer him. So then Pilate, this is what it says, Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of greater sin. So I think what you're saying here is that you've got the power to release me and the power to crucify me. So why do I refuse to speak to you? Well, how about you're in league with the devil, Rowan? I've answered that question millions of times. I'm not having anything to do with you. I'm not giving you what you want. So zip your trousers up and fuck off. So you say, Pilate, he's so silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. Do you not realise I have power over you, he says to Jesus. And the Lord replies, you would have no power at all over me if it had not been given you. Well, you're the Lord, aren't you? You're Lord Williams of Oystermouth. So I think you're the Lord that you're talking about here. You don't usually say the Lord. That's not a usual phrase for you. So you then say, Jesus breaks his silence in order to challenge what Pilate has to say about power. When Pilate claims a simple and absolute power of life and death over him, Jesus shrugs it off. Well, I'm shrugging off all your crap, Rowan, and you're not going to manipulate me, and I'm not giving you what you want. So you then say, and he goes on to explain that indeed he, Jesus, has authority, royal authority, but an authority that has nothing to do with battle, coercion, and domination. So this is the rule of three here, and you emphasise these three things. And I think one of the things that you're doing here is that you're refuting your involvement with the New World Order. And the name Battle here, you can see that on the screen there, that's John Battle, a former Labour Party Member of Parliament. He was an MP for quite a long time, and also when Tony Blair was Prime Minister. And he also did happen to be my MP. I was living in his constituency where I was living before in my house that I was thrown out of. And he's also a very prominent Roman Catholic in Britain. So when you say that you've been given royal authority, you're talking about being appointed Archbishop of Canterbury, aren't you, in a state church, and you're also in the House of Lords, and these are appointed by the Queen, although they're not chosen by the Queen, but she ratifies these appointments. So I think this is what you're talking about, having royal authority, being the Archbishop of Canterbury in a state church, as you were. But this has nothing to do with battle. You mean Tony Blair's government, don't you? And you're not trying to coerce and dominate me, are you, by engineering all of this constant abuse and harassment and me being sexually abused continually with remote weapons? Oh, that isn't coercion and domination then, is it? Not much. You're just gaslighting, Rowan. This is complete and utter bollocks. You're gaslighting. I've talked about your gaslighting in videos before. So it's a means by which psychopaths try and get their victims to depend on them for interpreting reality. You're gaslighting, Rowan. This is complete bollocks. You're a very coercive, domineering, bullying, abusive man, and you are involved with the New World Order. John Battle isn't involved with the New World Order, by the way, but he was a Labour Party MP and in Tony Blair's government, so that's why you've used his name here, I think, to allude to this situation. So you then say, referring to Jesus again, his authority, and this takes us back to the themes we've been reflecting on in earlier evenings, his authority is simply the authority of truth. And you emphasise truth, and you do this silly thing, emphasising the th sound at the end of the word, the authority of truth. He is indeed the word made Flesh, and you emphasize flesh as well. So this is a way of describing Jesus, actually, that he's the Word of God, the Word incarnate. God took human flesh in the person of Jesus. So I don't think that's what you're referring to. And this is why you haven't got any authority, Rowan, because you never ever tell the truth. You always lie. So you then say, what does Jesus have to say? A message, a mission statement, a philosophy, a morality? So I think you're talking about the missionary position here again, aren't you? And you later on say that Jesus isn't bringing these things, but there's an example of some morality he brings on the screen there. And of course, he was born Jewish, so he didn't need to bring his own morality, did he? Because he was born in the Jewish faith, and God had already given the law to Moses for the Jews to follow. So he didn't need to bring a morality, but that doesn't mean he didn't have one. So you then say, no, it seems, and you sound quite indignant or sulky there, it's hard to tell which. What Jesus has to say is Jesus. What Jesus communicates is his own story, his identity, a fact of his living and dying. This is just noise pollution. It reminds me of Vergon poetry, actually, from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, this next section, because in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, it's actually preferable to be immediately exterminated rather than have to be subject to Vergon poetry because it's so terrible. So I've put a clip of that in later on in the video, but this is what the next piece of drivel sounds like to me. So you then say, that is the Word of God, not something that can be distilled out of his teaching and reduced to the level of fridge magnet philosophy. Well, you don't really have to distill anything out of his teaching, do you? Because there's quite a lot of his sayings in the Gospels. We can look at them and we don't have to listen to this self-indulgent garbage that continually streams out of your mouth, do we? And I suppose you're accusing me of fridge magnet philosophy. Well, go right ahead. I don't care because you talk nothing but crap. And whatever you say, I'm still not giving you what you want. So there we are. So you then say, Jesus is the Word made flesh. What Jesus communicates is Jesus. So perhaps it's in that encounter with Pilate that we see where so much of our reflection this week is leading. Again and again, we've come up against. Oh, yes, come up against. Again and again. Oh, yes, again and again and again. Year after year after year. And I still haven't given you what you want. And I'm never giving you what you want, partly because I know how much this infuriates you, and that makes me laugh. Again and again, we've come up against this simple theme. Jesus displays and enacts, you emphasize that, power by being who he is. So I think you're talking there again about me saying you're trying to force me to act out your perverted sexual fantasies about me. By being the one in whom the compassion of the eternal is flesh and blood. So this is all going on forever, which you've told me about a million times already. And I've said it can't possibly go on forever because we're both going to drop dead one day. So you then say, by being the one in whom what God most deeply wants is completely real and effective. So you emphasize deeply wants there. So I think you're God, aren't you? You certainly are in your own estimation. So you're God, and you're talking about in whom what God most deeply wants is completely real and effective. Well, I suppose you're talking about your inadequate and diseased crotch area, which you've been trying to force on me now for about 25 years. And your clown shoes aren't completely real and effective, are they? They're a sham, just like everything else about you. So you then say, we are pointed back repeatedly in these stories to a story of Jesus as a matter of exposing. And you emphasize exposing here, and then you leave a big gap, and then you say, God as God is. So, first of all, I thought you were talking about indecent exposure. You may be alluding to that, but I think you're also alluding to the Marillion song Incubus again, which I've read the lyrics out before of the whole song just about, but it was a long time ago, so I'm just going to read the relevant section now, which has this word in about exposing. So here we go. The dark room unleashes imagination in pornographic images in which you will always be the star. Untouchable, unapproachable, constant in the darkness, nursing an erection, a misplaced reaction, with no flower to place before this gravestone. And the walls become enticingly newspaper thin, but that would only be developing the negative view. And you have to be exposed in voyeuristic colour. This is the exposure here, I think you're talking about. And you have to be exposed in voyeuristic colour. The public act lets you model your shame on the mannequin catwalk. Let the cat walk. And the cat walks. I've played this scene before. Eye the mote in your eye. So I think that's what you're referring to here when you're emphasising exposing. We are pointed back repeatedly in these stories to the story of Jesus as a matter of exposing, then you leave a big gap, God as God is. The simple thereness of God, the godness of God. This is the Vogue on poetry again, the noise pollution. The God who doesn't depend on a majority vote for his policies. So you're still sulking about the American presidential election and Brexit. The God who doesn't wait to be popular with us. The God who doesn't need to be persuaded that we are lovable or that the world is worth transfiguring. So God loves everybody. So he doesn't need to be persuaded that we are lovable, but we are made lovable by the love of God, and you have rejected that love completely. You've sold your soul to Satan, and you're trying to drag everybody else down there with you, particularly me at the moment. So this makes you quite unlovable, really. You're really not helping the situation. And of course, just because someone is lovable in a certain sense doesn't mean you have to jump into bed with them either. I know you're quite confused about these things, but there are all different kinds of relationships that don't involve sex. Or breasts, for that matter. And transfiguring the world, well, you want to be selling everyone into slavery and exterminating everybody, don't you? Because you're working for the New World Order. And you're obviously superior to everybody, so what does everybody else matter anyway? So you then say, the God who is what God is and does what God does, and whose love and purpose can therefore never be deflected or disillusioned. So there's more Vogue on poetry there, but I think you're God here once again, aren't you? And your so-called love and purpose can therefore never be deflected or disillusioned. So I can't deflect your so-called love, which is actually just narcissistic delusion. And it can't, certainly can't be disillusion. So if we think about disillusionment is the removal of illusions, and you're clinging on to your illusions, aren't you? Your delusions that you're superior to everybody, that you're the centre of the universe, and that you are in fact God. So there's no deflecting you from those delusions, are there? So you then say, and that means that in the face of a lot of noisy challenge and questions, God's characteristic response is silence. So You do talk about silence quite a lot a bit later on, but that's the end of what I'm talking about this evening. But you do keep repeating the word silence. So I think you may be alluding to a Simon and Garfunkel song here, The Sound of Silence, because it also fits in with the theme of darkness in the part of the Marillion song Incubus that I've just read as well. Where it talks about constant in the darkness. So here's this Simon and Garfunkel song, anyway, The Sound of Silence, some of the lyrics from it. Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again because a vision, softly creeping, left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams, I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone. Neath the halo of a street lamp, I turned my collar to the cold and damp. So you may be alluding to the caricature of a prostitute standing under a street light here, since you were telling everyone all over the world that I was a prostitute. And then later on in the song, it says, "Fools," said I, "you do not know, silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words that I might teach you, take my arms that I might reach you. But my words, like silent raindrops, fell." That's the Sash song, isn't it? Raindrops, the one that you were quoting when you thought I was in the audience, a clip of which is in the end of all of my videos. And echoed, so my words, like silent raindrops, fell and echoed in the wells of silence. And the people bowed and prayed to the neon god they made. So I think you may be alluding to that song. And there's also a Sarah McLachlan song, well, a Delirium song featuring Sarah McLachlan, called Silence, which uses the word release as well, and you use that repeatedly in this sermon later on in a part I'm not covering this evening. So I've put a clip of that in later in the video, but I'm coming up to my time limit on this video, so I can't say any more about that now. So just to remind you, I won't be seducing any priests over the weekend, but I will be turning up to make a citizen's arrest for terrorism as soon as you're available, so don't forget to be alert. Hasta la próxima. Oh, and I suppose if your wife isn't with you in New York, she's probably already enjoying herself with her Rastafarian boyfriend. I should keep thinking about that if I were you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have been reflecting this week on the way in which the story of Jesus' trial and death transforms how we understand power. This week, on the way in which the story of Jesus' trial and death transforms how we understand power.
I got my papers in a cyanide pill. My Polaroids are taser in disguise. There's a face in the hood, and the beetroot looks like candles in November.
We have been reflecting this week. Way in which the story of Jesus' trial and death transforms how we understand power. And last night, in our journey through these narratives, we were thinking about how Jesus' capacity to uncover.
I'll drive you crazy.
And last night, in our journey through these narratives, we were thinking about how Jesus' capacity to uncover the real questions people are asking, rather than the ones they think they are asking, is one of the manifestations of transforming power.
do like, you know, like I'm a breast man. I like breasts, you know. Yeah, I really like boobs. That's my thing. Boobs. Breast is chicken. I don't want a breast. If I want a breast, I go to Popeyes. I don't want a breast. I want some nice boobs. But
here, God's pressure to be in the world, God's will, God's self poured out in what we can only think of as a divine desire.
Because we have, of course, in our education and our so-called maturation, skillfully and comprehensively trained ourselves out of receiving. Think about so much of what we imagine education is about.
I want some nice boobs, but
last night, in our journey through these narratives, we were thinking about how Jesus' capacity to uncover the real questions people are asking, rather than the ones they think they are asking, is one of the manifestations of transforming power. We were reflecting on that moment in his trial before the high priests.
Everybody comes to Hollywood. They wanna make it in the neighborhood. They like the smell of it in Hollywood. How could it hurt you when it looks so good?
We were reflecting on that moment in his trial before the high priests, as recorded by St. Luke, where he is asked, "Are you the Messiah?" and replies bluntly, "If I tell you, you will not believe. If I ask you, you will not answer." And that takes us forward into the next phase of his trial before Pontius Pilate, this time as it's narrated in the Gospel according to St. John. St. John emphasizes very strongly that initially, when Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, he says nothing. So silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. "Do you not realize I have power over you?" St. John emphasizes very strongly that initially, when Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, he says nothing. So silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. "Do you not realize I have power over you?" he says to Jesus. And the Lord replies, "You would have no power at all over me if it had not been given you."
Give it to me, baby, like boom, boom, boom.
St. John emphasizes very strongly that initially, when Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, he says nothing. So silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. "Do you not realize I have power over you?" he says to Jesus. And the Lord replies, "You would have no power at all over me if it had not been given you."
And late that night, when the Lord came home, inquiring of his lady, oh, the servant said, "On every hand, she's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsies, oh."
"Oh, saddle me up my milk-white steed, go and fetch me my pony, oh, that I may ride and seek my bride, who's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsy, oh. Through the wood and the copses too.
Well, what care I for my house on my land? What care I for my money, oh? I'd rather have a kiss from the yellow gypsy's lips on my way with the raggle-taggle gypsy, oh.
What care I for my goose-feathered bed with blades? blanket strewn so calmly, oh. Tonight I lie in a wide open plain in the arms of a raggle-taggle gypsy, oh.
Night I lie with me back upon the ground in the arms of a raggle-taggle gypsy, oh.
St. John emphasizes very strongly that initially when Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, he says nothing. So silent is he that the Roman governor is astonished and eventually challenges Jesus. Do you not realize I have power over you? He says to Jesus, and the Lord replies, you would have no power at all over me if it had not been given you. Jesus breaks his silence in order to challenge what Pilate has to say about power. When Pilate claims a simple and absolute power of life and death over him, Jesus shrugs it off. And he goes on to explain that indeed he, Jesus, has authority, royal authority. Pilate claims a simple and absolute power of life and death over him. Jesus shrugs it off. And he goes on to explain that indeed he, Jesus, has authority, royal authority, but an authority that has nothing to do with battle, coercion, and domination. On to explain that indeed he, Jesus, has authority, royal authority, but an authority that has nothing to do with battle, coercion, and domination. His authority, and this takes us back to the themes we've been reflecting on in earlier evenings, his authority is simply the authority of truth. He is indeed the Word made flesh.
I don't like if you love me, love me, love me. I'll drive you crazy.
And he goes on to explain that indeed he, Jesus, has authority, royal authority, but an authority that has nothing to do with battle, coercion, and domination. His authority, and this takes us back to the themes we've been reflecting on in earlier evenings, his authority is simply the authority of truth. He is indeed the Word made flesh.
I want some nice boobs, but
here, God's pressure to be in the world, God's will, God's self poured out in what we can only think of as a divine desire. But back to the central language of the kingdom and what's going on in the kingdom and what's going on in the person, young or old, who's somehow found themselves close to the kingdom. Interesting.
I want some nice boobs, but
his authority, and this takes us back to the themes we've been reflecting on in earlier evenings, his authority is simply the authority of truth. He is indeed the Word made flesh. What does Jesus have to say? A message? Mission statement.
The missionary man, he was following me. He said, stop what you're doing, get down upon.
message for you that you better believe.
His authority, and this takes us back to the themes we've been reflecting on in earlier evenings. His authority is simply the authority of truth. He is indeed the Word made flesh. What does Jesus have to say? A message? A mission statement? A philosophy? A morality? No, it seems, what Jesus has to say is Jesus. What Jesus communicates is his own story, his identity, the fact of his living and dying. That is the Word of God, not something that can be distilled out of his teaching and reduced to the level of fridge magnet philosophy. Jesus is the Word made flesh. What Jesus communicates is Jesus. And so perhaps it's in that encounter with Pilate that we see where so much of our reflection this week is leading. Again and again, we've come up against this simple theme. Jesus displays and enacts power by being who he is, by being the one in whom the compassion of the eternal is flesh and blood, by being the one in whom what God most deeply wants is completely real and effective.
Yeah, and with a thing that tiny, you're going to be hard put to please anything.
Again and again, we've come up against this simple theme. Jesus displays and enacts power by being who he is, by being the one in whom the compassion of the eternal is flesh and blood, by being the one in whom what God most deeply wants is completely real and effective.
I don't give a fuck.
Again and again, we've come up against this simple theme. Jesus displays and enacts power by being who he is, by being the one in whom the compassion of the eternal is flesh and blood, by being the one in whom what God most deeply wants is completely real and effective.
What did you say? Oh, you're breaking up on me. Sorry, I cannot hear you. I'm kind of busy.
We are pointed back repeatedly in these stories to the story of Jesus as a matter of exposing God.
And you have to be exposed in voyeuristic color. The public art. Let you model your shame on the mannequin catwalk, catwalk. Let the cats walk. And the cab walks.
We are pointed back repeatedly in these stories to the story of Jesus as a matter of exposing God as God is. The simple there-ness of God. The godness of God. The God who doesn't depend on a majority vote for his policies.
I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States
Donald J. Trump is now President of the United States.
Listen,
hear? That is the sound of communist suffering.
We are pointed back repeatedly in these stories to the story of Jesus as a matter of exposing God as God is. The simple there-ness of God. The godness of God. The God who doesn't depend on a majority vote for his policies. The God who doesn't wait to be popular with us. The God who doesn't need to be persuaded that we are lovable or that the world is worth transfiguring. The God who is what God is and does what God does. And whose love and purpose can therefore never be deflected or disillusioned. Exposing God as God is. The simple there-ness of God. The godness of God. The God who doesn't depend on a majority vote for his policies. The God who doesn't wait to be popular with us. The God who doesn't need to be persuaded that we are lovable or that the world is worth transfiguring. The God who is what God is and does what God does, and whose love and purpose can therefore never be deflected or disillusioned.
What the hell's that?
Well, if we're lucky, it's a Vergon guard come to throw us into space.
And if we're unlucky?
The Vergon captain might want to read us some of his poetry first.
Fertile grunt muggly, thy micturations are to me as fertile devil blockets in a lurgid bee that morbiously hath blurted out its earth and jumbles into a rancid vestred quotation. Now, the jerking, slated agrocrustules are slurping.
The God who is what God is and does what God does. Whose love and purpose can therefore never be deflected or disillusioned. And that means that in the face of a lot of noisy challenge and questions, God's characteristic response is silence.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again, because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping.
And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound
of silence.
Long live the king, yo, I'm from the Empire State. That's
that night when the Lord came home inquiring of his lady, oh. The servant said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsies, oh.
The footman memorized the number, but the prince still holds both the slippers. And would you leave a palace for a bed set and Canterbury tales?
Oh, what care I for my house and my land?
What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.